starting the movement. And as many of you know, there's a tremendous movement now. It's really taking off in a lot of places. But one of the things I said that night was, we have to have the Native Hawaiian leadership in our movement, yeah? And we've made some strides. But what I'm hoping for tonight is that we make a substantial change in that direction. Because what we're gonna be talking to you about is new emerging technologies. And we're gonna say, this is a great opportunity for us to step up all that we do, and to come forward, and to be more inclusive, and to work harder, because you'll find out you're gonna wanna do that. I know that I was trying to retire, and when I found out about gene drives, particularly in Hawaii, I got all fired up. I said, we can't do this, you know? But now we have an opportunity to do it in a different way, in a better way. So the first speaker, so this is how it's gonna go. I'll tell you that first, and then I'll introduce the speakers. Walter Ritte, who many of you know, is a Native Hawaiian activist from Molokai, been a very substantial leader in the community. He's gonna come up first, and he's gonna set the theme. He's gonna sort of say, why are we here? So actually, why don't you go come up when I introduce you, and then go maybe sit up on the stage. Could you do that one? No, Walter, okay, come on. We're gonna let them do it their way. So Walter's gonna set the stage a little bit for us there. And then we're gonna have our first speaker, who's going to speak for a little bit longer. And her name is Hokulei Lindsey. Hokulei Lindsey is a Native Hawaiian lawyer. She's done a lot of work on protecting traditional knowledge of Native people and intellectual property rights. And she'll be telling you more about that work and where we need to go forward with the Ike and with Native knowledge as we build our new movement here. And then the next speaker is gonna be Dana Perls. Dana, over here in the blue dress, is from Friends of the Earth, US, and she has a lot of expertise on this technology. She's gonna give you some definitions. She's gonna talk about 5 minutes on defining some of these technologies that we've been talking about. And then Jim Thomas, over here, from Canada, from the ETC group. And Jim's gonna speak a little bit longer. He's gonna put some of these technologies and the work that's being done into context, and talk about what's driving the need for this particular conversation here in Hawaii right now. And then we're gonna go back to Dana, and Dana's gonna lay out some of the dangers and some of the consequences of the technologies that we're gonna be talking about. We didn't wanna front load all the bad news, okay? And then we're gonna wrap up again with Walter a little bit, 5 more minutes, because Walter, we're gonna ask him to set the pace for where we go from here. Show us the way forward, okay? Then we're gonna have questions and answers. And Mary, did we get cards for people to write on? Yes, Mary over here, we have cards. There's not, you know, I think we can take some pop-up questions as well. We'll try and see how that goes. But some people are more comfortable writing their questions on the cards. And please feel free to write your questions, hand them to Mary, and then we will go to a period of discussion and question and answer, okay? So the next thing we will do then is ask Walter to come speak. Please welcome Walter Ritte.
The lighting's better.
Well. So I went to Kamehameha schools. I know how to take orders. So. Aloha.
Aloha.
Aloha kako. And my name is Walter Ritte from the island of Molokai. And I flew in today because of all of these people. I learned a lot. So I was here at the IUCN for a couple days, then I flew home for a couple hours, and then I had to fly back. And that took a lot of persuasion for getting me to fly back again. Molokai It's different. And when I get to Molokai, I have a really hard time leaving Molokai. So the reason I'm here tonight is really, really important. And I wouldn't be here if it wasn't. So by the end of the evening, you're going to understand what took me 3 days to understand. But basically, we're talking about the second wave. Most of you out there were part of the first wave. The first wave of GMOs to Hawaii, we made a lot of mistakes. And now there's a second wave that's coming, and it's worse than the first wave. It has much more dire effects and consequences than the first wave. The positive side is that they're just now coming. So if we act quickly enough and organize fast enough, we will be able to control this wave, if not get rid of it. We had a very hard time with the first wave of GMOs because we didn't know they were here for at least 5 years. On Molokai, nobody really can get on Molokai and develop without everybody knowing. And that's how we stopped all of the developments on Molokai, because as soon as you got off the plane, everybody knew, uh-oh. They know how you dress, whether you get shoes, if you get coat and tie, you're dead. So how did Monsanto get to Molokai without anybody knowing for 5 years? So that's really the story of how they came to Hawaii. By the time we got involved and knew that these fields that used to belong to the University of Hawaii for research was bought by Monsanto, and the science never changed, but the activities were changing. While we were there sleeping, they were at our legislature buying off all of our politicians. In fact, they started at the national level with the President of the United States and worked their way down. So by the time we got involved, the doors were all closed at the legislature. So we ended up on the streets, thousands of us, marching on the streets on every single island, because we could not get a voice at the legislature. So today we find ourselves like deadlocked. The legislature is basically neutral. They cannot get nothing passed and we cannot get nothing passed. So now that this new wave is coming, we need to be smarter and quicker. So the first inkling we got was at this last weekend at the IUCN. They unveiled their plans. So these guys are not coming here like the first GMO guys, purely for profit, just to sell their seeds, make their money, and one of these days just leave. They came last week and said that they're coming here to save us. They're coming here as conservationists, and they want the conservationists to support whatever they're doing, because they are going to kill the mosquitoes that are killing our birds. They are going to save our ohia forests. They are conservationists. So that's the face that they presented. And then when you read all of the fine prints and everything that's going on, and you're going to find out a little bit later what's really going on, it's very, very dangerous. As somebody who cares for the environment and has kuleana to the environment and has battle scars for the last 20 years from these GMO companies, I'm here tonight. And the reason I'm here tonight is to try and rebuild our army that we started with the first wave of GMOs in order to get ready before they take over, to get ready early, to organize, and to make sure that whatever they're going to do, it's not going to be done without our participation and our blessing. So listen really carefully tonight. And before you go home tonight, make sure we have your name and your address and everything else, because there's going to be work to be done. And once you find out what is going on, you're going to want to join us so that we can control this new wave that is coming to Hawaii. Thank you.
A
Aloha. My name is Hokulei Lindsey, and I am here. Well, I am happy to be here this evening. And my role on tonight's panel is to talk about traditional and customary practice and traditional knowledge. So, from a Native Hawaiian perspective, what does this technology mean? And how do we protect those practices in this new age of or second wave of genetic technology? And I was thinking about this today, and I've been thinking about it for a while. I don't want to make it seem like I was thinking about it today. I was thinking about it for a while, trying to prepare for this evening. And I was talking to Claire on the phone this morning, and she shared with me some insight about storytelling and being a translator, and or feeling as though one is a translator and viewing oneself as a translator. And that brought to mind the way I viewed myself in going to law school, that I was in a position that not many Indigenous people get to be in, and that not many Native Hawaiians get to be in. And I saw my role as walking into worlds and being a translator from the Native Hawaiian community to the legal world. And with that thought in mind, there was another thought that had been just kind of nagging at me almost from the very beginning when I was asked to do that, this. And it was just this little kind of seed in my memory. And I need to do a little bit of a disclaimer because I am not a hula person. That tradition was not passed to me. My grandmother was a hula teacher, a kumu hula, and my aunt is a kumu hula. But like I said, I'm not a hula person. That was not in my path. But there is a mele, and it has to do with the kiamanu, the bird gatherers, the Native Hawaiian bird hunters. And they would gather feathers to make those beautiful capes and helmets for the alii. And this mele tells the story of these bird hunters, these kiamanu, when firearms were introduced to Hawaii. And all of a sudden, there was this new technology, this new tool, this new toy that they had. And it seemed to make things so much easier, right? Instead of having to go into the forest and set nets and capture the birds and pick off the feathers one by one and just a few from each bird, they could shoot and have the bird and get the feathers. And how easy was that? Well, this mele tells their story, and it's a lament. Their lament, looking back at what they did, at the mistakes that they made, and how sad it was that they played this role in really a twist of fate, because all of a sudden the birds were not as fruitful as they were, or as numerous as they were. And part of that was their fault. They played a role in the destruction of the birds and in the unraveling of their own livelihood and the unraveling of that portion of Hawaiian culture, which just, as you know, culture is intertwined with everything. And they played a role in this unraveling. And the mele tells that story about how sad they were and how they could not go back. And so I tell that because it feels very similar to me to be up here tonight, because with Hawaiian culture and traditional practice, it's a worldview of interconnection. Several years ago, 2002, I had the honor of working with some leaders across cultural practitioners, different practices, and with an organization called Ilio Ula Okalani, which was a coalition of Kumuhula and other native practitioners. And we got together in a conference called Ka'ahapono, and we talked about these technologies, we talked about the biodiversity, we talked about traditional and cultural practices, and we drafted a declaration, and that declaration is known as the Paokalani Declaration. And it sets a framework, but one of the things that really stands out to me, one of the paragraphs that to me really captures this worldview and this interconnectivity goes like this. According to the Kumulipo, a genealogical chant of creation, Ho gave birth to the world. From this female potency was born Kumulipo and Po'ele. And from these two, the rest of the world unfolded in genealogical order. The foundational principle of the Kumulipo is that all facets of the world are related by birth. And thus, the Hawaiian concept of the world descends from one ancestral genealogy. We are all part of that genealogy. Every aspect of the world that surrounds us is part of that genealogy. We exist in interconnected, familial, interrelated, dependent relationships. And the thing about this technology is, just like the birds and the kiamanu, when you unravel, right, you pull at one string, you don't know what other strings are also gonna pull. And so I think that's the bigger picture. And the smaller picture is one of self-determination for Native Hawaiians. How do we protect our traditions and our practices? Well, we practice self-determination. It's like a circle, we come full circle. When you assert your practices, when you go out and you do it, you assert determination, self-determination. And when you do that, you're perpetuating your culture, you're practicing your culture, and you're there to help preserve and protect it. It's one big circle. Again, one big interconnected circle. And I think that's a good place to leave us for now, and maybe we'll come back around. But thank you. I'm filled with so much hope after listening to Walter and Hokulei. Thank you. Aloha. My name is Dana Perls. I'm with Friends of the Earth US. I'm here from Berkeley, California. Just breathing in what you shared, and I apologize for switching the very beautiful mood for one moment, but I hope that you really hold on to what you've just heard as I explain what is this technology that we're referring to. So overall, in general, genetic engineering is shifting. It's evolving, as any technology would. In general, what we're looking at is the next generation of genetic engineering, GMOs 2.0. And it's this merger of engineering and biology, some of which we've already seen over the years, and some of which we couldn't have imagined. And this technical evolution has raised concerns that go beyond and above the concerns from first generation GMOs. In general, this is not about transgenics anymore. So first generation GMOs, you take one DNA from one organism and you insert it into another. And this is more about the engineering of a process. You might still be inserting genes, but it's not dependent on an organism anymore. You can fabricate DNA from scratch, insert it, silence it, repeat it. So it's a deeper level of intervention into DNA from the very building blocks of nature. It's a drive to design, patent, and profit from DNA at the industrial level. It's predicted to be at a $40 billion industry by 2020. So part of it is that this goes beyond plants, this goes beyond what we've known as agricultural crops and GMO crops. This is a technological platform that is looking to be applied to plants, insects, animals, humans, bioweapons, right? This is a platform. And what we're going to talk about today is one particular application that is being brought to Hawaii as kind of the poster child and more or less the guinea pig. So synthetic biologists draw from a whole variety of approaches. Synthetic biology is kind of what we call this next generation, this evolution of genetic engineering. And this can involve creating new DNA in order to reprogram or entirely create new life forms. And that again is, you know, with silencing genes or deleting genes or adding genes. And I'll give you one example in the creation of new products. Like vanilla or stevia, for example, one might know, I want to make vanillin, and you know what that molecule, the one molecule that you're going for is, and you can sit down ultimately at a computer, at a DNA processor, so to speak, type out your computer code, print out the DNA sequence that you want, insert it into yeast or microorganism like algae, let it live by feeding it sugar, and rather than squeezing out beer, it's going to squeeze out vanillin or ginger or sandalwood or ginseng. And so ultimately you've created a factory from a microorganism to do whatever it is you're needing. Now that's just one example. There's a whole suite of examples. But ultimately, it's not about engineering the final product, but the entire life process. And so one particular example that brings us here today is the gene drive. This is one type of synthetic biology. And it's one of the most powerful and extreme and I would say dangerous and concerning examples of synthetic biology. So imagine that by releasing a single fly into the wild, you could thereby alter all the flies on the planet, causing them to turn yellow, carry a toxin, or go extinct, just by releasing one organism. This is a gene drive. So this is a very controversial extinction technology that can permanently alter a species by releasing one bioengineered individual. And it perpetuates itself through future generations. So it's not just this generation, it's not just this room over here, but for all future species, you have just completely permanently altered it. And that might be to carry a certain trait, or it could be to drive it to extinction. So again, this idea is to spread traits through generations of species. And that's one of the proposals that's being brought here to Hawaii, which is to take this Culex mosquito that carries the avian malaria, which is connected to the decline of the honey creeper. And if we could just drive this mosquito into extinction, then maybe that would solve the problem and the honey creeper would live. So it's this idea of a silver bullet by permanently removing a species from its existence. That's the idea. It doesn't actually exist. And I just want to add that this is not conventional breeding, which is some of the lines that industry feeds. These gene drives allow biotech companies to really engineer and manipulate life in a way that conventional breeding would ever do. And I also just want to say that I know that there's a lot of media around the GMO mosquito that is being proposed for release in Florida. The GMO mosquito is different from the gene drive mosquito, which is raising all of this alarm here in Hawaii. The GMO mosquito seeks to reduce mosquito populations, but will require constant release. It doesn't permeate and perpetuate itself in a population. Whereas the gene drive mosquito, which is what we're talking about here,
seeks to drive a lethal gene throughout an entire population to kill it off. And just to say that this is not a containable technology, right? The design is to not be contained, but to spread. So on that awesome note, I'm going to leave it there, and then I'll return to help think about what are some of the concerns.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Can you hear this okay?
Yeah.
And thank you very much, Hokulei, and also Walter and Dana for that explanation. My name is Jim Thomas. I work for an organization called Etc. Group. And we track new and emerging technologies. And feel very honored and very appreciative to be able to be here to be part of this conversation. I've never been to Hawaii. I had an uncle who lived here in Honolulu, a great uncle who lived here in Honolulu, and every year he would send us postcards saying, "Aloha from paradise," but I never went there. And he was a military scientist who worked on the atom bomb, on the Manhattan Project. And so this piece of paradise has always been connected with large-scale, risky technologies. And now it is again, unfortunately. Obviously, as somebody not from here, what I can offer is a perspective from somewhere else. And so what I would like to offer is just four views from places I have sat through my life, in a way, and see how that helps in this discussion. The first is 20 years ago. So 20 years ago, where I sat was in the United Kingdom, or stood, in fact, where I was involved in creating a grassroots movement against genetically modified organisms, against GMOs in agriculture, because of the unpredictabilities, the concerns that this is a technology that was unjust and unpredictable and so forth. And that was that first generation of GMO crops that we were able to pretty much drive off of our island, just as you've been working here to drive it off of your islands. If I think back to then, back to 1996, when genetic engineering first came along, the genetic engineers said, "Listen, this may be unpredictable, but we're going to keep it in the lab. It's not going to get out of the lab." And then they said, "We're going to have it in small trials, but it's not going to get beyond those small trials." And then they said, by 1996, "We're going to let it into certain crops in agriculture, but it ain't going to get past the agricultural fields. Don't worry about it. The genes aren't going to leak out." And then a few years later, they said, "The genes leaked out, but it doesn't matter, because once they get into the wild, they'll get overwhelmed by nature and they really won't survive." And here we are 20 years later, where they're promoting a technology that not only is intended to be released into the environment, into the wild, in fact, not only is it intended that those genes will not get overwhelmed, but they will propagate, the intention is that those genes will take over the entire species and even crash those species. It's kind of astonishing. If you told me 20 years ago about gene drives, I would have said that was a ridiculous conspiracy, that was science fiction. Wouldn't be possible. Of course, if you told me that Donald Trump would be running for president, I would laugh in your face too. And you know, this is the thing. Things that are unthinkable propositions become scarily close to actually occurring. And that's what we're talking about here in Hawaii. Another place where I'm sat. I sit on a small international expert body. It's called the UN Ad Hoc Technical Expert Group on Synthetic Biology. And you've heard a little bit about synthetic biology from Dana. It's under the Biodiversity Convention, which is 196 countries. The reason the United Nations Biodiversity Convention is interested in having an expert group on synthetic biology is because synthetic biology is a major threat to biodiversity. That this new and souped-up genetic engineering platform raises new threats to biosafety. It raises new issues around livelihoods, particularly livelihoods of farmers and indigenous peoples. And the 196 countries have called for stronger regulations, the precautionary principle, and so forth. Most of what's going on in the synthetic biology industry, which Dana referred to, is this idea of re-engineering organisms in bats so that you can produce synthetic versions of things like vanilla or patchouli and things like that. And even that's going to have an issue for Hawaii. Just last night I was talking with my hosts about the kava plant. And it turns out that synthetic biologists in my hometown, which is Montreal in Canada, have sequenced the genetics of the kava plant. And they are now working on engineering yeast to produce kava synthetically. And I have a suspicion there's probably not been any agreement with the peoples of these islands or any other Pacific islands behind that. But mostly, in this work looking around synthetic biology, I want to talk about a third place where I found myself sitting. So this was in April 2013. And I found myself invited to a meeting in Cambridge in the UK, at a very luxurious meeting with lots of wine and food and feasting on hand, called Synthetic Biology and Conservation, in which the organizers have brought together the leading synthetic biologists and some of the leading men from the conservation world, and they really were just mostly men. And the purpose was to see if they could kind of match them up. It was all couched in dating terms. The idea was that they would come together and they would conceive of new ideas. And there was a really seedy undercurrent where they were talking about the conservation world as these kind of tired old men who needed to be pepped up by the sexy young area of synthetic biology. And they kept asking, what do you think you can come up with? And they would say, well, maybe we could engineer corals to resist climate change, or maybe we can make synthetic rhino horn. And every time they said that, they'd quickly write it down and turn it into a science project. That was 2013. Gene drives didn't exist yet. But it was the beginning of a process where a series of strategic meetings were being organized to try and come up with an iconic project for synthetic biology. The idea would be a project that would sell synthetic biology as a way to solve conservation challenges. So just as GMOs will feed the world and nuclear power will solve climate change, then the hope was that synthetic biology could be the answer to the sixth great extinction. And through a series of meetings, they focused on what was going to be their iconic project that would show that synthetic biology would solve the extinction crisis. And that was the idea of saving the honey creeper in Hawaii using gene drives. The group realized that Hawaii was an ideal place to launch this project for three reasons. One, Hawaii is seen as the extinction capital of the world. If you can do this here where the crisis is real, so it acts as a beacon for the rest of the world to use synthetic biology to solve conservation problems. Secondly, the global conservation body, IUCN, was going to be meeting in Hawaii. Wonderful, you could get a two-for-one punch. You could impress the Hawaiian government and the IUCN body all at the same time. And they went ahead with trying to put in a motion and trying to set up some glossy events. Thirdly, Hawaii is part of the USA. I don't need to tell you this. It's a place with a biotechnology industry that's quite strong. And most importantly for them, the US is one of the only countries, one of two, that haven't signed the Biodiversity Convention. The other one's the Vatican. So having decided this, and having found an individual who they said would be their front person amongst indigenous peoples, they moved ahead with trying to promote this idea for Hawaii. In the meantime, the topic of gene drives has gone from 0 to 60 at amazing speed. Creating an urgency to find a positive example for gene drives as well as synthetic biology. The very first gene drive was produced at the end of 2014, so barely 2 years ago. By this summer, the US National Academy of Sciences had a 200-page policy report paid for by the US Department of Defense and the Gates Foundation. And we're starting to pour big money into moving forward gene drives. Bill Gates just this week doubled his investment to $75 million in gene drives. And an NGO called Island Conservation, which seems to have several hundred thousand maybe dollars to move forward a project to release gene drive mice on islands, said they wanted to do so by 2020. So the urgency for these people to have an iconic project is really there. So the last place I find myself sitting is here, in front of the people who that iconic project, should it become real, are most going to affect, or at least going to affect first, because gene drives don't stop in one place. The point of them is they keep going, and ultimately can go global, and certainly the policy implications go global. In the last few days at the IUCN, we've seen the results of those planning meetings that the Gene Drive guys had. They had two very glossy events introduced by Hawaiian singing by the person they identified a year ago. Right now, they're having a meeting for the next 2 days in the Big Island with government officials and with scientists and with journalists pushing forward their proposals. And however, their plans aren't going quite so smoothly. The motion they put forward at IUCN mutated under the power of common sense to actually be a motion that called for them not to support gene drives. That's kind of embarrassing for them. And 30 leading environmentalists, Vandana Shiva, David Suzuki, Jane Goodall, Walter, published a letter speaking out against it. And perhaps most importantly, maybe this has even started a discussion here in Hawaii, not just about how to address, how to protect the birds in question, and how to address the very real extinction crisis from an indigenous perspective, not from outside with a hail of silver bullets. That's for Hawaii to decide, and I'm sure Hawaii will decide it very sensibly and wisely. I know it's not enough just to be sitting in the place where you are and speaking from the space where you're sitting. Ultimately, you have to think from the place where you are. And then, of course, you have to stand up and defend the place where you are. Mahalo.
I feel like I keep coming back and bringing in these negative news after such uplifting things. Thank you so much, Jim. So I just want to ground a little bit more. We've just heard, what is synthetic biology, and Jim has shared kind of the evolution of how did we get there, and a bit about the PR strategy landing here in Hawaii. And I just want to name really quickly some of those concerns and the questions that come to mind as we think about what could possibly go wrong with an extinction technology that is unassessed and unregulated and uncontrollable. And I want to really call into what we've heard before with Hokulei about this worldview of interconnection, and with what Walter was sharing about whose land is this, and what role people play in land management. So I'm going to first list some environmental concerns, safety concerns, and the question of regulation. So in general, the ways that these synthetic biology organisms, particularly the gene drive, will interact with nature is completely unpredictable and could be potentially devastating and permanent in terms of its impacts. So as we've heard, gene drives intend to permanently alter a species. So this is going to also have irreversible ripple effects throughout the web of life. They may drive a species into extinction or drive diverse traits out of a population. It's also important to remember that this is uncontainable. Some scientists refer to this gene drive as a global gene drive because they spread across boundaries. If there were a gene drive released in California, it would not screech to a halt at the boundaries in Mexico, right? So this is an issue that is not going to be contained. It's designed to not be contained. It's also an issue that these gene drives may lead to mutations. An engineered mosquito might start off in one form, however, evolution always takes over, and even a genetically engineered mosquito will still evolve. And so how will these mutations evolve with the environment? If a mosquito is eradicated, will another or more aggressive mosquito come in and fill its niche? Regardless of whether or not gene drives actually work to drive something into extinction, what are the significant ecologically disruptive impacts that it will have, right? This is actually not about whether or not it's going to work, but what are the impacts that it's going to have, the unintended consequences that could leave permanent impacts on the land here and throughout different species. Also, even though we're not talking about we're not talking about agriculture right now. If this were applied to agriculture, the impacts could be severe, right? Agribusiness has a real serious interest in redesigning seeds and weeds that will maximize profit potential. And secure food systems, particularly in a very climate uncertain future, requires maximum diversity and resilience, not less. So it's really important to remember, right, we all know that biology is not an engineering discipline. And so to treat it as such is not going to work. Or if it is going to work, what are the other implications that it's going to have, and how does that disrupt everything? Secondly, I just want to talk about biosafety concerns. And the fact that we don't fully understand this science is really important to remember. The risk assessment that we might call for is actually not the end game at all. It's not very clear whether or not it's possible to do the sort of holistic, full assessment of what happens when you release a gene drive into an environment. But just to start, less than 1% of the funding that goes into synthetic biology goes into environmental risk assessment, or that goes into looking at the concerns. Right, so more than 99% of the funding is just to develop the thing itself. And that's something that's really important to know, that we're flying forward with technologies that we don't fully understand. And then lastly, this is something I'm sure you can imagine, GMOs are barely regulated, but there are currently no regulations for these new emerging technologies, let alone gene drives, not nationally or internationally right now. It's not even clear whether robust regulations and oversight is even possible for such a technology, and yet we're seeing it race forward with proposals. So this right now, the entire synthetic biology industry relies on self-regulation, right? As if you're a company and you're doing your finances and you can do your own self-audits. We're allowing companies to do their own environmental self-audits. And as a result, very little is known about the safety or the impacts that these technologies will have on the environment and people. I think with the international regulations, that's a must, right? This is not about national regulations. As the NAS study said, these gene drives don't know political boundaries. So it's really not up to the United States to decide what should we do about this gene drive, but this has to be done internationally. And it needs to prioritize people as opposed to the profits, which is how we normally run. So I think only after these regulations and policies are in place can we even go on to the next step, which is to discuss how would we assess this, and what kind of regulatory oversight and commercial control would be appropriate if we were to prioritize the environment and people. So this is just a couple of questions to plant some seeds in your mind. Thank you.
Give each panelist the time now to comment and come back and maybe follow up on some of the other things that have been said. Right. So I'm going to start with Hokulei. Right. Make some more comments on what you've heard so far, and then Jim, Dana, and then Walter at the end. In the meantime, excuse me one sec. Are there cards? I will go down and see if I can collect some cards and review the questions while they're speaking.
Hokulei. One of the things that came to my mind, you know, Claire mentioned in my introduction that I, and I think I did mention going to law school. So, as an attorney, and having this steep learning curve here this evening, I started thinking about, you know, what are the things that we can do here in Hawaii. You know, on the one hand, I've talked about from a Native Hawaiian perspective and just taking that action of cultural practice, getting out there. But from another perspective or another angle, what can be done? And Hawaii has, the state of Hawaii has
a constitutional obligation. Think about this, a constitutional obligation to protect Native Hawaiian traditional and customary gathering rights. The people of this state voted to accept that. That's not just about Hawaiians. It's about everything that's here. Because as we've talked about already, it's a web of interconnectedness. If you insert, as we've heard, a gene drive into a mosquito, or you figure out a way to manipulate and synthetically create kava, or the one that Hawaiians have been fighting for a long time, kalo, right? If you insert that and you manipulate that, you are manipulating the traditional and customary right to gather, because you've manipulated the traditional and customary gathering thing, right? You've manipulated that relationship between humankind and nature. And the practice, while you may be gathering the plant, the relationship is no longer the same. Those of you that have been in Hawaii for a long time, I'm sure within the environmental movement, as well as within the various aspects of Native Hawaiian rights and Native Hawaiian movements, have heard about the relationship between Native Hawaiians and kalo. And again, it's that same idea from the kumulipo. It's familial and reciprocal. You manipulate and you change kalo, you're changing us. You're changing our genealogy, you're changing who we are, because there is no separation between us. So one other thing that came to mind, going back to the Paukalani Declaration, is there is a paragraph, several paragraphs about scientific research, one of which says, we have the right to free, prior, and informed consent before research relating to our biological resources commences. Researchers, corporations, educational institutions, government, or others conducting such research must fully and entirely inform Kanaka Maoli regarding the purposes of their research and recognize our right to refuse to participate. So it's a discussion that goes both ways. But ultimately, Kanaka Maoli population has the right not to participate and has the right to say no for Hawaii. One other thing that came in speaking about the laws and policies of the state of Hawaii, on the heels of the Paukalani Declaration, so in 2004, the Hawaii legislature adopted Senate Concurrent Resolution number 167, and this recognizes Native Hawaiians as traditional indigenous knowledge holders and recognizes their collective intellectual property rights. And in that resolution, it calls for, you know, scholars and researchers to consult with Native Hawaiians. It calls for the University of Hawaii to start behaving differently, which they have not yet done. But it does all of that, right? It's all here. It's all in the palapala, not only from our own community, but from the state of Hawaii.
Jim, do you have a comment?
There's actually a question about how gene drives work and whether or not, if you're bitten by a gene drive mosquito, would it harm a human? So maybe you could take that one.
I can do that. Can you hear me now? Yeah. So I'll explain how a gene drive works. First of all, what a gene drive does, the way a gene drive is made, is using a whole new suite of genetic engineering called gene editing. Some of you may have heard of this. The basic difference is that rather than cutting out a gene somewhere and moving it somewhere else, you go into the DNA and you sort of change it one letter at a time. That's the basic thing here. The way a gene drive works is that you engineer the organism so that when it reproduces and passes on its genetic material, it will always pass on the gene drive itself into the next generation. Usually, when you mate an organism with another organism and there's a particular trait, let's say blue eyes or blonde hair or something, there are some things that are dominant, so they're more likely to move forward. But generally speaking, you can assume a particular trait is going to, about 50% of the time, is going to move forward into the next generation. What a gene drive does is it builds in the genetic editing software, if you like, this gene editing process. It actually builds it in to the DNA. So once it gets taken up, so it goes through to the next generation, and then it gene edits both sets of genetic material, such that when that organism mates, it will always pass on the same genetic material, and then it will gene edit it and pass it on. It's a kind of copy and paste mechanism. Does that make sense? So what that means then is, instead of having sort of 50% of the time the particular trait you want, let's say you want to give a fly red eyes, 50% of the time the flies will have red eyes, otherwise they'll have normal black eyes, and over time you will lose that trait. With the gene drive, all of the flies' children will have red eyes, and all of those children will have red eyes, and all of those children will have red eyes, until such a time as you've changed the entire population of flies. And because flies move around a lot, ultimately you'll change the entire species of flies. And so that's the way in which that works.
Are there any driving comments that want to be made? Because we have some great questions, and I'd like to get to these questions, and then we'll turn up the lights and actually also have some participation.
I did want to add one thing, which I didn't say about this proposal, is that there are no permits for it yet. And really, this conversation, I just want to say, is really ahead of the game, right? There's a lot of base building going on with the industry, talking to conservation groups, trying to get buy-in. But this is still it's still in the works, right? There's no FDA permit yet, and some of the scientists have said, like, maybe this gene drive could be ready by 2020. But they want a commitment. They need a place. They need a cause. They need a poster. You know, they need something to attach it to. But I just wanted to say, with all of this urgency that some of these industries are promoting, that we need to do this now actually is a little bit from now. And that's why this conversation is so critical, because there's actually an opportunity to get ahead of the conversation and not be blindsided once the industry comes and presents some glossy presentation, right, that you're already prepared with all the questions and time to research and have this dialogue. So I just wanted to add that.
Thank you.
Walter.
You know, when I was talking to the state agencies, this business about now is really, really important for them. Because their response to me was, well, while you guys are talking about this and talking about that, the birds are dying, the trees are dying, so when are you gonna stop talking and do something? So they're putting pressure on everybody that we have to do it now, otherwise we're gonna lose all of our birds and we're gonna lose all of our forests. So that's the approach that they're putting out there. They're making this thing some kind of an emergency. So all of this information we're getting tonight is really important to answer that kind of push and that kind of now. We have to do it now.
Because I've been at this a really long time, I'm gonna intrude with a few little comments with my questions. I can't resist. Because something Jim said yesterday too, when we were talking, when we heard all the presentations at IUCN about gene drives, it was full of hype. It was just being, you know, we were told lies, and you have some experience with having people come in and lying about both, as has been mentioned, what's going to happen, but why it's necessary and the timelines. This is going on now, so it's going to be really important to be fully informed and to stick together and help each other figure these things out as we go forward. There's a good question, Walter, I'd like you to address, on how how GMOs infiltrated into Hawaii. Maybe even take a step back and say, you know, this is the history of Hawaii, people coming in and doing their, you know, proceeding on their own agenda and leaving out the Hawaiian people and leaving out who's here. So in this case, they wanted to also know what the role of the University of Hawaii was. And that's perfect for you. You've been there and done that.
As I mentioned earlier, when we first started off with the first wave of GMOs, we started late. And we were behind the eight ball. We were going uphill all the way. But that made us even work harder and harder. So right now, we're at the beginning. This is the beginning of this movement that's coming, this second wave. So we have a really good chance now to organize early and get to our politicians. The meetings they're having right now on the island of Hawaii is being put together by the University of Hawaii, Manoa. And then the monies are coming from Mayor Kinoe. I guess this is last hurrah monies he's going to give out. So it's happening right, the start is happening right now. So the intent we have right in doing all of this tonight is to try and introduce you to a group that's going to be putting a lot of energy and commitment into trying to get us all organized, and that's Hawai'i SEED. Hawai'i SEED got me involved in the first round, and they're getting me involved now in this second round because I kind of went off my way and started doing a lot of Hawaiian things and reminding everybody that there was an overthrow and there's no, and that this is an illegal government that we have. And I love doing that because it's all about truth. But this is so important that we're going to have to get our gangs back together again and make sure that we move together going forward. So this is the first meeting. So that's why we need to get contact with everybody. And we're going to have a second meeting. And at the second meeting, we're going to have to get all of these state people that are on the Big Island having meetings and being told A, B, C, D, E, F, G, whatever, to come and sit at a table like this and tell us what they have learned, what they plan to do, and where we're going to go with all this. We have to know and keep direct contact, and then later on bring our politicians and make sure that we got them under control. If we don't know what they're doing, then what we're going to have is we're going to have a full-on war like we did with the regular GMOs. And not very many people win those kinds of wars. So we have a really good chance now to organize early. And this is the first meeting. We're going to somehow get a date for the second meeting, and then we're going to be making sure that we keep talking about it and keep organizing and keep organizing. There's lots and lots of people out there that now know about GMOs. When we first started, it's a side note, but I was standing on Maui with my sign against GMOs, and all these Hawaiian guys was driving by in the car telling me, go back where you came from. And then I began to realize that when we went to the county council and I overheard them talking, they were saying, how dare these guys come off the boat, all these Howleys coming off the boat and telling us what to do. So this whole movement started out to be a Howley movement. And over the years, the Hawaiians got involved because now we started talking about what is happening to not only us as people, but to the aina, to the land, to the ocean, to the water. And that brought in all of the Hawaiian people. So now we got everybody's attention and we're all working together. So we need to just continue now and put our crosshairs, move it a little bit from the regular GMOs and concentrate on this really bad one called gene drive.
Jim, I know you want to comment. So would you work into your what you say, who are the actual people behind gene drives? And the person also wants you to know, who are the scientists who are speaking out against gene drives? Who's the science on what we were talking about?
So I was going to comment because the question was about the University of Hawaii. So there is actually a lab on the University of Hawaii that's working on gene drives. It's the Reed lab, Floyd Reed. I don't know if any of them have come today. And they have put in for funding from the National Institutes of Health to develop gene drive mosquitoes to fight avian malaria. So there is an actual project moving forward at the University of Hawaii. In terms of gene drives, where it's coming from, there are probably about 8 or 9 labs around the US that are developing gene drives, and they're doing it in mosquitoes, in fruit flies, in parasites, and in mice so far, but it will go into other things too. The money so far has come 50-50, I would say, from, as I mentioned, the Gates Foundation, and the Defense Advanced Research Projects Agency. That's a part of the US government, the US military, that develops kind of extreme technologies. The interest behind gene drives comes from four places. Military interest, agricultural interest, health interest, and these conservation uses. The one you'll hear about most is the health interest, because there is an argument to be made. If we can eliminate the mosquitoes that carry malaria, or you can eliminate the mosquitoes that carry Zika, then that could have a great public health potential. So that's why the Gates Foundation is interested. There are some very serious questions about changing the ecological balance still, and whether that's even going to work. But that's what you'll hear most about. The conservation applications you're hearing about right here in Hawaii. They're trying to create a case here in Hawaii. The military interests is this could be a fantastic bioweapon. If you can modify a parasite that would then be released and drive through all sorts of parasites in an area, or you can modify an agricultural crop and drive it through an agricultural crop, that could be an agricultural bioweapon. You can begin to see ways in which this could be of great concern. And the fourth is agriculture. And it's my belief that ultimately this is going to land in agriculture. We already know that Dow and Syngenta are interested in this technology in a very quiet way. Monsanto claim that they're not interested in it yet. They're keeping a watching brief. But the example that they give is that they would like to be able to modify the weeds on fields that are Roundup resistant. If you could put a gene drive into a population of Roundup resistant weeds, so that those weeds are then susceptible to Roundup, then once again Monsanto can start selling more Roundup. So you can see where that goes along the way. I don't know if that answers the question.
I'm going to direct a question at you, Hokulei. It's going to be a while coming, because I want to talk a bit about, there's been a couple of people raising it, issues of accountability and how we address in the courts and the corruption of government. So this regulatory capture, where we have regulatory agencies that are now working for industry. So we have that situation, and we have a regulatory framework which is not functioning to protect either public health or the environment. So those things are not working, and now we have this new technology which is even more dangerous and will have even greater consequences. So we don't have a regulatory system to address it. I think that's important. It's also a vulnerability, because perhaps local communities can begin to draft legislation and we can have other options. And one of the questions talks about, I think, in terms of accountability, that if the damage is done to intellectual property or traditional ecological knowledge, if something is destroyed, what are your thoughts about holding the people responsible and accountability in that context, in the cultural context?
Well, I think part of cultural practice and working or living within those interconnected relationships is, right, there's certain values for Hawaiian, certain cultural values. Malama'aina is one that we hear a lot about. We also have kuleana. And kuleana is not just responsibility, but responsibility with accountability, which means, you know, just that, to be responsible and take responsibility for the actions that you take. And I think, from my perspective anyway, that would mean not only engaging in the practice, but and asserting your rights that way, and fighting for protection in that context of practicing and asserting self-determination, but also for some, that I would think that also means pursuing other legal remedies. Claire mentioned, one aspect of grassroots organization is to work through the legislature.
And one of the things with the legislature, you know, we were able to hold a conference and pull together leaders within the community and create a statement on behalf of that conference, and coming from leaders within the Native Hawaiian community. And so when you have, one of the great things is when you have that kind of collective voice, and you go to the legislative body, it tends to be that much more powerful. You know, when they passed, I mean, it's a resolution, right? But in 2004, when they passed Senate Concurrent Resolution 164, I'm sure they had no idea what they were saying, right? They had no idea of the impact of it, what potential it could hold. But today, we have a resolution that identifies Native Hawaiian intellectual property rights and a collective ownership over these things, and recognizes traditional knowledge and the importance of traditional knowledge, not only to Native Hawaiians, but to Kapai Aina Hawaii and the general population here in Hawaii. So I think that organizing is a huge thing. We're used to organizing, I think, when you're involved in social types of movements, collective voices, you know, gathering a collective statement, more than a petition, I think, a statement that is put together and researched and taking that to the legislature. For me, even though I'm a lawyer, I think courts are kind of the last place to go. They are a valid place, and when the system is broken, right, we've got three branches of government. When the regulatory system is broken, when the legislative system is broken because they've all been infiltrated, the courts are the final branch to go through.
Well, and somebody else mentioned the political system, so, right? So we need to work politically, we need to get political, right, too, Walter?
I'm trying to think nice. Take a deep breath. This system is screwed. I mean,
yeah.
I don't know how else to say it. And I'm not saying it because I read a book, you know. I'm saying it because I've been involved in this system. And I'm up to here, you know. And it's not only happening at our level, but it's all the way to the top. I mean, we're making jokes about people running for president, you know what I mean? Things are crumbling. So these regulatory agencies, I mean, we were dealing with them with the first round of GMOs. You know, APHIS, these guys and this whole office that's supposed to manage and take care of all the farmland to make sure they do everything right. They had an F grade when they came to investigate this APHIS guys that's supposed to be taking care of our concerns. And then when you go to the state level, they don't have enough employees. And then we go to the county level and we get like, yeah, we marched 2,000, 3,000 guys. The county passes a resolution and then the state passes a law that the county cannot pass a resolution. Then we go to the state and the state passes, you have to label, and then the federal government passes a law that the state cannot make a. So it's, I don't know how much we're going to be able to take as people, because now we're talking something really serious that could go wrong. So, you know, it's like when we tried to do the fish ponds. We were not fish ponds. We were navigable waters. We were wetlands. We were all these kinds of things that we've never heard of. No, we're Hawaiians doing traditional things. No, you're having an outflow. Every time you move your rocks, the dust is coming in the water. There's discharge in the water. And the same thing is happening in a sewage plant. So they're comparing us to a sewage plant, you know. So I'm up to here. So in this case, because we're so early, I'm willing to say, let's play nice. Let's call the university guys to the table. Let's hear what they got to say. But be ready to do whatever we got to do on this one. because the regulatory agencies are not going to be our solution.
That's right.
That's my belief. I really believe that.
Thank you. Dana, you want to just...
I just wanted to bring in an example of another place in the U.S. that's in a somewhat similar fight, which are local residents in Key Haven, Florida, who are currently fighting against the GMO mosquito, which is kind of the first step to the gene drive.
They wanted to know the tactics of the GMO mosquito, so.
Oh, the tactic. Okay, so right now the fight in Florida is we're going to start with this GMO mosquito, which is different from the gene drive, and the idea is that it's going to reduce the mosquito populations and cure dengue. Well, one, there is no dengue in Key Haven, so I don't know how they're going to be able to tell if they've cured dengue. But what is happening is the people have risen up. Right, the people have protested. Similarly, they said, hey, there's this law that says that you have to hold a public meeting in Key Haven and you have to ask the people. And a couple days later, there was a regulatory change and that clause was removed. So they no longer have to consult with the people. I think they forgot about it and they overlooked it and they said, oh wow, crap. So it was the fastest regulatory change I've ever seen. And part of what the people were asking is who is accountable? When the GMO mosquitoes are released and the Asian tiger mosquito moves in and fills the niche and carries all the same diseases, who is accountable? When the bat populations change, who is accountable? And the FDA said not it, and the USDA says it's not a plant. And Oxitech says we're just a company, it's just a tool. We just make the tool, you guys do the thing. So it's a not it game. And certainly if we can't figure it out with the GMO mosquito, the government regulations are definitely playing hot potato with this question of public accountability, environmental responsibility, and conversations with the public. And I think that there is that lesson to be learned anywhere, right? Is to hold government agencies to the fire and say, here are the questions. And certainly because the industry, Revive and Restore is the name of one company that's going out and saying, you know, it matters what you guys think. If Hawaii says that we don't want this, then certainly we're not going to force it. That's kind of the front, because they've learned, at least proverbially speaking, that they're supposed to be in favor of public participation. And so in forcing that and talking to the regulators and asking those questions and showing what the public thinks and being in dialogue, I think are really critical. And that's part of the reason that the Florida Key Haven residents right now are ahead of the game. And the decision of whether or not to release the mosquito is now coming down to a ballot vote in November. It was supposed to just be a vote in Key Haven. Then they took a poll and learned that the vote was probably going to be no, and they've expanded the range of the vote to more of the state where the mosquito won't be released, right? But so there's lots of really slimy tactics, but ultimately it's because the people are on top of it, on top of the facts, talking to regulators, holding their feet to the fire, and the people's voice in the community is the loudest.
So we're going to... Also, there's a lot of questions, I think, and I'd like to give people some resources so that they can go do some research on their own as well and ask you if you have anything on websites or what you might have available. We've written a brief on gene drives called Reckless Driving, Gene Drives and the Act of Nature, and I believe that's on the SynBio website.
There's also copies in the back.
All right, and then we did this letter, A Call for Conservation with a Conscience, No Place for Gene Drives and Conservation. This was signed by many scientists as well as environmental leaders worldwide that Jim had mentioned. And that is also on, I guess, is that on the Hawai'i SEED site as well? Yeah. And where can we get the Paola Kalani Declaration? Is there a copy somewhere else to see? Posted? I think if you Google that word.
There's a PDF.
Yeah. If you Google it, I think it should come up, and I think that there are copies in the back as well. There are copies in the law library or the Supreme Court library. If you want to go to the law library, you can also get it if you go online and you Google Howard Law Journal, because I wrote an article that was published in the Howard Law Journal. You can Google my name or look up the Howard Law Journal, and it was published in winter of 2005. And it's printed in that journal as part of my articles. And that's free. They have an archive of.
So the theme of the rest of the questions are strategies, where we go from here, what we should be working on together, how we go forward. And I'd like everybody here on the panel to make suggestions about what they, the vision they would see. Some people want to know what other countries are doing. Dana, you know, who else is working on this? Another, or Jim might have that information. You mentioned the CBD, you might explain that. But then let's bring it down here, Walter, with how we're going to go forward here in Hawaii. I know you said next meeting, but maybe let's talk about strategies. And then let's open it up and have some comments and questions from people out there, and we'll do our best to bring you together. We have a microphone that'll be coming around. So I'm just going to go down the line here with Dana, starting with you, strategies, and where we go from here.
Well, I'm going to definitely defer to everybody in this room. I've met some of the most incredible activists, and you guys have been at the spotlight in terms of really leading a lot of movements. I think that there's opportunities for a lot of collaboration. Certainly, Friends of the Earth is a place that we can offer a lot of information, provide resources, help. I mean, we want to be coalition partners. And as we've heard several of the panelists already talk about, Walter and Hokulei and also Jim, that this is a movement issue, right? This is actually not just about GMOs anymore. This isn't about agricultural crops or one particular issue. This is about a way of living. This is about the sacredness of life. This is about the sanctitude of how we go about our life and being able to decide what is here. So in terms of strategy, I think there's a lot of conversations that need to be had. I think that it's important to know what are all of the other strategies that are being laid out to protect birds. I think it's important to talk to the other conservation groups on the island of Hawaii, to talk to all of the other activists and in different issue areas, to really be spreading the word. And in terms of local strategy of talking to government agencies, I feel like you guys are going to be the expert on that, but to keep the information flowing and to keep the dialogues between as many different groups, not just in Hawaii, but tapping into the resources on the mainland as well.
I think that one of the things that comes to mind, you know, there's been a lot of mention about being in this conversation early. And so one of the challenges with that is also one of the opportunities in that. In what I mean by that is with organizing and gathering together, community voices can start to shape the conversation, which is a powerful thing. One of the things that we did is when we put together the Paukalani Declaration is we looked and we tried to get every other declaration about traditional knowledge that was out there that we could possibly get our hands on. And we worked from there. We borrowed, we did a lot of borrowing, but ultimately it has to come from your center, right? It has to come from Hawaii. And so we have an opportunity to do that sort of thing, to organize and to shape a conversation and to, you know, maybe even work with the Paukalani Declaration because it sets out a framework of how to frame a conversation and to really start to exercise, you know, to use the legal terms, a sui generis system of protection, right? Sui generis, it means something that is unique, something that is of itself, something that comes from a particular source. So to direct the conversation, use our language, right? That's one of the other challenges for Indigenous people and Native Hawaiians is we try to get people, you know, the law and the political systems all try to put you in a certain box. This is where you fit, right? With
like Walter was saying with your lo'ikalo, the water is going back into the stream and being compared to sewage and polluting the streams. No, that's not it. That's a different vocabulary. That's a different situation. So to use our language and language that's appropriate and fitting for us and our situation is key to this. And being out in front is a great advantage.
We're just going to finish a couple of comments, or can you wait 1 minute? Oh, okay, come on, come forward. No, you wait. Okay, all right, thank you.
Thank you. I'll try to be quick. I think I'm going to say something similar, but I want to just tell a story from another movement. In 2001, the indigenous people in Oaxaca, in Mexico, discovered that their maize, which is the basis of the culture in Mexico, had been contaminated by genetically modified maize. And this was pretty shocking and upsetting, because that's the original source of maize diversity and of their culture. At the time, as the communities came together and tried to understand how to respond to this, the proposal was put forward by very well-meaning and helpful scientists that they could set up a series of labs in the communities. And those genetic labs could test the maize and find out which maize was contaminated. And that was thought to be a way in which they could get back in control of their maize. The communities talked further and discussed and reflected on this, and they said no thank you to that. And the basis on which they said no thank you was that this was not a solution that came from them. The genetic technologies, the labs that would be required, was not their own knowledge. It was not something they would be able to sustain. It would require continually expertise from outside. And that instead this wasn't about the genetic contamination of the seed, it was about reviving their own peasant seed systems. And so instead they took a much longer approach and set in place a plan to bring back and defend peasant seed production and learn to defend the production of maize. And there is now a very powerful movement in Mexico called the Network in Defense of Maize that has been not just bringing back, protecting maize. And I somehow, to me, that's a useful basis of the question here. Is not about the bird. It's not about just this one thing. It's about, from an indigenous point of view, dealing with this crisis of extinction. So.
What I wanted to ask is, Walter, isn't there a conservation council at the state?
Yeah. I didn't want to leave all of you with the impression that if we organize, all we're going to do is tear down walls and burn down the police station or anything like that. It's just my frustration. But what she's asking is a really good question, because what we're going to do is we're going to organize. And when we organize, there's going to have to be all these fingers that's going to go out and do all kinds of things, including what she's talking about, where there's a couple empty seats on that organization. We need to go ahead and lobby the government to put people that we want on those things. There's politicians we gotta go after. There's University of Hawaii people we gotta go after. There's constitutional law, Article 12, Section 7, there's 7-1 laws. There's all kinds of things that are gonna help us to do what we wanna do. And we gotta do all those kinds of things. So organizing, I mean, we've been doing it so long, we can do it in our sleep already. All we need is people. We know all the buttons that we're going to have to push in order to get to where we want to go. So my whole intent is to try and figure out how to bring people together. And I've been working with a lot of different organizations, and then, you know, we've got people fighting water, we've got people on the mountain fighting for sacred sites, we've got people fighting all different kinds of levels and battles. So the trick is going to try to be somehow involved enough to bring people together on this one issue, and then also help them with their issue, and to form coalitions. That's what it's going to take. So we're going to be the new kids on the block, trying to, hey, what about, oh yes, water, yes, Mauna Kea, yes, but oh, what about this one? And then now the Hawaiians especially are getting interested in what's happening with the Indians.
Yeah.
And it's becoming a big issue. I mean, I'm getting phone calls. We got to go start fundraising to jump on a plane and go over there and help those guys too.
Yeah.
So it's, we're not the only place. I mean, people have been telling us about it's happening all over the place, but we have to do our part because we're just little dots in the middle of the Pacific. And if it's going to happen to anybody, it's going to happen to us first. Yes, Terry.
Also, the second thing is to Lindsey, if you could put some language together, it's for OHA. You need to educate them.
Yeah.
But have some language already prepared. See what they want you, you know, to do for us. I mean, there was a pamphlet, a leaflet on the IUCN, and people going in and talking about recommendations to the body. That's the kind of thinking and planning and activity that we need as a follow-up to tonight.
Thank you, Tim.
OHA voted to support the Hokulei Declaration back in 2003. Yeah,
and they
voted to support that resolution. So the board may not be up to speed on it, but you know that vote exists and that support exists.
So I'm going to open it up a little bit more with the microphone coming around. And would you raise your hand if you would like, so Mary can see you if you want to have a question? While you're doing that, I just wanted to add my own little insight from being an activist for over 50 years. And I want to honor Mahialani Cipher, who is here. She started when she was a young mother. Would you stand up, please? As a young mother, she started working on the H3 to protect Halama Valley and Haiku Valley. And now her great-grandchildren are working on it. So my point with that little bit is to say never, ever, ever give up. Some of this work will always be done in our lifetimes. We have to keep at it no matter what.
Hi, my name is H. Doug Matsuoka with the Hawaii Gorilla Video Hui. You know, up till now we've been talking about Western corporations, Western national interests. My understanding is that Syngenta was recently purchased by a Chinese corporation. Does anybody have any idea of what that changes and how to deal with Chinese corporations?
I can talk a bit to that. So yes, Syngenta is being bought by Chem China. The deal hasn't entirely gone through yet. Perhaps what's most significant is it's happening now with a wave of these mergers. So as well as the Syngenta Chem China deal, we have Dow and DuPont trying to merge. Bayer today just upped its offer for Monsanto. So we may well end up with a Monsanto-Bayer deal confirmed even this week. And that means that the big six are coming down to three large companies and one very tight, one now smaller company would be BASF. And all of this is actually just pre-moves for when the large machinery companies like John Deere move in and start to buy them all up. So, you know, that's the question about how to deal with a Chinese company. You know, I think these mergers actually aren't done yet. They can still be derailed. And this is another discussion, but right now investors and merger and regulatory agencies responsible for monopoly are very shaky about these, and they can be stopped in national governments. And they'll be stopped because there'll be public concern about it. The public will be saying loud and clear, you can't get away with this. And so I...
You think that will be sufficient to actually stop these things from happening?
It's doable. It's really hard, yes. It's really hard.
Can you follow up, Jim, and talk about the inevitability argument that people make that if we don't have the gene drives that are being proposed by US companies, that China will do it? Can you follow up with that?
Well, I mean, these companies these days aren't Chinese companies or French companies or US companies, they're international companies. And you know, this speaks to the reason why this discussion needs to also be happening internationally. Synthetic biology is under discussion at the US Convention, International Convention on Biological Diversity. China is bound by that, just as France or Europe, any European country, and actually generally respects decisions there. And so there's going to be a move. The next meeting of the Convention on Biological Diversity is in Cancun in December. And there's going to be a move by some countries, hopefully, and certainly by civil society to push for a moratorium on gene drives so that the international community can clearly say we don't want this. It'd be interesting if something's happening here in Hawaii about gene drives and anyone can get to Cancun to represent that. This is going to be used at Cancun. This is going to be used as the example of why we need gene drives to save biodiversity. And so it's going to be interesting to have voices from here that have different points of view.
Dana has a comment. Is there another question first?
Yes.
Oh, sorry.
Hi. My name is Karen. And I had a question about TPP and what effects it might have. Would the Hokulei Declaration stand up to something such as TPP? And I toyed with the idea of the best defense being an offense, proposing to shrink Hokulei as an alternative to gene drives.
I'm not sure that I understand the question, put it that way.
Would TPP, for instance, override some of these?
TPP will override all of that. Yes.
I think, I mean, that's the fast answer.
Yeah. It's a race to the bottom. You know, it's the lowest common denominator when it comes to environmental regulations, but certainly a local, even state law is not going to override an international regulation, or a trade law, rather.
Did that answer your question? Okay. This gentleman here.
We have been seeing that the seed companies or the big corporations are using the same strategies that the tobacco companies used to use and that the big oil uses nowadays. Answering the question that he was asking before about, you know, if we don't do it, then there will be somebody else to do it. That was exactly what they were saying about the Keystone Pipeline.
Yeah.
And still we drove it out of business, and one of the consequences of doing that was that a lot of pipeline projects have been canceled and they are not happening anymore. So that is not a good argument, you know, in their favor at all.
Next, anyone?
I want to thank you all for this wonderful wealth of information that you're bringing to the community, but I also want to ask about next steps, Walter, and how we can organize and dust off our capes to be on the front lines again for this next movement.
Yeah, I'm going to speak a little bit for Mary over there. Hawai'i Seeds. We're going to have to, we didn't know how many people were going to show up. We didn't know how this thing was going to happen. So now, at the end, we're going to sit down and decide when our next, we're going to have another meeting, that's for sure. So Hawai'i Seeds is going to have to be the one to announce it out. So make sure we have your contact numbers and stuff. It's a step-by-step process. This is the first step, second step. We're going to meet again. We're going to do better organizing. We're going to ID what kinds of things we need to do as a group, what kind of people we're going to ask to come in, how we're going to expand, all those kinds of things. So it's going to be a growing process that we're going to do. We're not going to solve everything here tonight, that's for sure.
And as far as the long-term timeline that we know it is soon but not so soon, do we have insider information to tell us what that timeline looks like?
So, Dana, go ahead, Dana. I think that we're trying to find out some of that insider timeline. Part of this secret meeting that Walter alluded to on the Big Island is to discuss some of that information. What would be a reasonable timeline, who needs to be involved, that sort of thing. So, the developers, one of the developers of the Gene Drive said, well, this is not likely to come out for 10 years, but then Revive and Restore and Island Conservation might be like, no, we're ready to go in the, you know, by 2020. So there's not clarity, right? These are all discussions behind closed doors, but it means that their lack of clarity also gives you guys time to have the conversations that you need to do the research, to line up our coalitions and our collaborations. And it doesn't mean, you know, that we need to take to the streets tomorrow, but rather it's quite the opportunity to be raising these questions, put more you know, sticks in the wheels, so that things get locked up with questions and pointing out where the dysfunctions are. Jim, maybe you have other information.
At IUCN, the group who were pushing for this were saying very clearly that the time is ticking on the honeycreeper and avian malaria, that, you know, there are something like 35 species left of honeycreepers, and within 5 to 10 years we could be seeing some of those extinct, and that's the timeline which they want to intervene. That timeline, however, when you look at the technologies they're promoting, it's probably not going to line up. What they're going to probably say is that the GMO mosquitoes that they've been using in Key Haven, they can use those, and they can use them in the next couple of years, but in fact they can't. They're the wrong species, and even if they could do the engineering to put them into the right species, they would have to sex sort them, because they only release males, and that's a complicated thing, and they don't quite know how to do it in that species. So probably, even with the GMO mosquitoes, it will end up being something in the region of 5 years before they release them. And certainly the gene drive doesn't exist yet. So a lot of this is going to be, it's going to be a PR battle. They're going to be saying, we want you to buy into this now, we have to move ahead with it now, and that this is urgent, ultimately so that they can push this as a PR problem. And probably the deeper question is, in the meantime, if the threat's true, if it's really true that there's going to be species of honeycreeper disappearing in the next 5 years, this isn't going to help it. Question is, what is?
Yeah, just to really emphasize that they really want a commitment. They want a place to show that this is going to happen. And if it does, it's not going to be about the honeycreeper. It's going to be about Hawaii being a global example of a new technology platform. And so that timing, I think, is really important.
So the question we posed tonight was, who decides for Hawaii? And I would like to invite, there are many people in this room, Hector, Cha, Mahilani, others who I can't see, who have a lot of experience with organizing, with a lot of experience in how to move forward on community activism. And I'd like to invite you to say what you think we should be doing now. Where should we be headed in from your perspective in how we take next steps for who decides in Hawaii? But you had another question too. Is there another question behind you?
Yes, I have a question or a comment. My name is Cliff DeVries. The thing that we see with this genetic modified organism situation is the fact that many people are uninformed about the situation. You know, you look at state legislatures and U.S. legislatures, like, for example, Senator Hirono, who voted in favor of this mock GMO labeling bill, and you can see that people just don't have enough information to make a proper decision. I mean, they're influenced by the money, you know, from Monsanto and from other companies. They just don't know the seriousness of the situation. We have a technology, as we talked about, the gene drive is even worse than the GMO situation. We have a technology that really no one knows very much about. I mean, to change the DNA of a living organism and have everyone eat that all the time is something that's quite, I mean, if you look at it more deeply, quite horrifying. And with the prospect of, you know, wiping out the entire crop with the disease, you have a monoclonal crops out there that a disease could come and wipe out the entire food supply for the USA. I know maybe that's not so serious, but, you know, we have some huge concerns. So I think by educating the people and, you know, being sensitive to the fact that these people have no realization as to what the problem could be, and Monsanto and other companies have hidden, you know, the dangers of these technologies. You know, it's anyway.
some ideas.
Well, public education is going to be super critical to getting the expertise, getting the voice. Some comments on, if there are no comments on strategies you want to come forward with right now, then we're just about ready to wrap up. Cha Smith, long time activist.
Well, I want to caution against a regulatory approach. That would be like putting lipstick on a pig. So let's just abandon that concept of we can regulate this out of existence. I think one of the most important things we could do and should do right now is call for a moratorium on that lab. That's public money being spent for unknown, psycho, crazy technology that we don't want anything to do with. The other thing is there needs to be the ethical issue brought up about manipulating life. These white guys are crazy, and they are trying to play God, right? So this is like not on the table. They don't get to take this to any further level. It's like, no, just gotta say no, 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 not let's, how can we make it better? How can we mitigate this? It's not even a discussion. It needs to be shut down immediately.
Thank you.
Robin Midkiff, Atherton Family Foundation. I also was attending the IUCN World Conservation Congress. So what I was hearing from the U.S. Fish and Wildlife folks was that the timing has to do with the temperature. So the issue being that the honey creeper right now on Kauai is up above 4,000 feet. The mosquito can't go above 4,000 feet at this temperature. But the climate scientists are saying the temperature is going up, and therefore the mosquito will be able to go higher to a point where I don't know how high Hawaii is, but it's not, I don't think it's higher than any mountain on Oahu, for example. So it probably is in the more, I would think, in the 15 to 20 year time span that we're really talking about. So my thing on this is organic, cover cropped, no-till agriculture to start sucking more of the carbon back down and taking these fields that have been sterilized with the pesticides, herbicides, chemical fertilizers, and changing them, not just in Hawaii, but we could lead the way in terms of doing it with the governor committing to doubling our ag lands by 2020. We could really focus on making those organic agriculture and be a model for the mainland, just like we're doing on the energy side of things. So that would be my 2 cents on where to go.
Thank you. Jim, did you want to comment on that honey creeper aspect?
No, that's exactly how I understood it as well. It was to do with the climate change changing the altitude at which the mosquito is going. So, I mean, some of the things that were said in IUCN, you know, those who were presenting this and pushing for it were making the argument that the mosquito in question, Culex, is actually an invasive species, and therefore you could take it away. It was an invasive species that came over in the mid-19th century, and therefore it's no problem if it disappears. They did admit that the hoary bat eats some of it, but it's not a big part of the hoary bat diet, they said, that the hoary bat could do without it. I think those are things we need to ask whether that's really true, and some of these other claims too.
We need more science. We need to fund public science to give us the information that we need to be able to talk about how we do save the birds in a culturally appropriate way with community consent, right? So, there's another point. Thank you, Mary.
Hi, I just wanted to know if you guys know what species UH Lab is
gene manipulating?
Well, the proposal is to manipulate. They're doing some work at the moment already on a kind of gene drive, but not the sort of gene drive that is effective, frankly. But their process, which is called a CRISPR gene drive, they're proposing to use the CRISPR gene drives, which are the really effective gene drives, and they're going to do it in the Culex mosquito, which is the one that carries avian malaria. So the reason they're doing it is to attack the avian malaria question. So the latest we know is that they're putting an application to the National Institutes of Health. So at this point, they're just applying for funding.
So do you have any idea how far along they are?
I don't, and I think that's a very good first step, is to go and talk to Dr. Floyd Reed.
When was the application?
That was, I think, July.
July, so this year?
Yeah, but they're already doing work on genetically modified mosquitoes to deal with avian malaria, so I think that's part of the research that needs to be done to understand how far they are.
Is it only the mosquito? Because I know UH does a lot of fruit fly, Drosophila research, genetics.
I'm not sure.
They have proposed what they call a daughterless mouse. One of the gene drives that's being proposed is a gene drive that eliminates all females in order to crash the population. And I think as just a concept, it's appalling.
At UH?
I don't know if it's happening at UH, but one of the island conservation proposals is to have what they call the daughterless mouse.
I'm just very concerned with UH. They're kind of responsible for the papaya virus that forced all the farmers to buy the UH GMO seed. So if UH accidentally releases their gene drive anything, we're screwed. It doesn't matter if we regulate or do anything. So I agree with yeah, what she said, shut down UH is the best thing we can do at this stage until we know what they're doing up there. The potential for what they've done irresponsibly for everything, I mean, TMT, everything.
Yeah.
It's just UH has no good record, so.
Just to, on that point, I mean, there is a real, so very often campaigners against genetically modified organisms would say, if it's in the lab, don't worry about it. The problem here is that because once this is out of the lab, and if it finds a host and reproduces, it will take over the entire species. Any escape from the lab is a problem. So it's an absolutely valid question to say to UH, how are you proposing to contain something that if even just one gets out, is going to change an entire species?
Right.
I don't think that's a good
question.
Do you
guys know where the lab is?
That's the question. That is the
You're
question.
You're talking to Walter, who chained up the lab over the GM Taro Kahlo, you know, so we do. You know, I think maybe it's time to have a conversation amongst ourselves, but I hope that if we do have a second meeting and we continue this, you'll bring more people, spread the word, help us get organized. Walter, would you Mahielani, please, Mahielani Cypher.
Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Okay. I just had a couple of thoughts about the strategy that you folks talked about. And somebody talked about public involvement meetings that are being offered or proposed. And you know, if you ever had to deal with EISs and they have public comment periods, all it is comment. And they still can ignore you after they've done public involvement. So, but what Marjorie Ziegler has done with many environmental organizations and Hawaiian organizations in recent years is she has persuaded a lot of people to do the right thing and to pressure the legislators because they are afraid of losing votes. And especially in the second year of the term when they're up for re-election or whatever, they do listen. So it can work, but you have to have your own timeline. That's one thing. The other thing is, if we only had all those millions of dollars, $75 million, to find healthy ways to save species, like they did with the alala crow. You know, I mean, Keith Robinson from his Kauai and Niihau, he had collected all these seeds of endangered species, rare Hawaiian plants. And instead of listening to Fish and Wildlife, which told him he couldn't you know, raise these plants and cut them or do anything with them, he took the seeds and he gave it to the public, thousands of seeds over like 20 years ago. And he said if the backyard gardeners could grow these seeds again, they'd no longer be endangered. And to me, if we could raise birds that can be healthy and strong again and other creatures that are endangered in more places, maybe not in these tiny labs, maybe we have more, with all the resources that are spent on these artificial ways, that's the problem. And maybe the solution is to do it the right way instead of finding these arbitrary weird ways that maybe aren't necessarily good. If you don't know all the answers, then maybe we should go down that road. Science is always about exploring, though, so I think we have to be prepared, or you have to be prepared for the good side of science. There is a good way. There's a purpose for everything in existence. There's probably a purpose for a good purpose for the mosquito, but we have, I don't know what that is. Some of you may know. Anyway, that's all I wanted to share. Thank you.
Mahalo. That's a good one. Okay. We're wrapping it up now. Walter, do you have a final comment? You're our leader.
Yep.
Okay. All right. Let's everyone give ourselves and the panel a hand.
Yep. Thank you. And thank you for joining us. We're going to be cutting off now. This was presented by Hawai'i SEED.
Okay, so I talked at great length with Paul Campbell from Island Conservation.
Yeah.
And what's going on the mice, which is very scary to me, is New Zealand has voted to ban mice, or ban, get rid of, mice, rats, and stoats by 2025. Okay, so the gene drive on the mice is focused on New Zealand. So this may be something where people want to talk to a Maori friends about doing something in New Zealand, because I think you start talking about, I'm scared of the mosquitoes because of the shikimate pathways in our bacteria, but when you start talking about mice and then rats, well, what do they use to do experiments on in the labs to look at humans, mice and rats? So,
okay, thanks for joining us. This was about new technology of gene drive.
Thank you, everyone, for coming, and we have a lot of work to do, and we have your emails, hopefully. If you haven't signed up, please do. We'll be having a meeting within the month. We'd like to thank our Olelo students, filmers, Kayoung Ju and Maya. We'd also like to thank H. Doug Matsuoka for the live stream, Kathy Maddox. There is a lot of food. Please take some food home with you. And also, can we have a round of applause for our panelists, Hokulei, Dana, Claire Cummings, Jim, and Uncle Walter. Thanks for coming tonight.
Thank you, Mary Lack.